Jackson Palmer, the founder of Dogecoin, believes that cryptocurrency is a scam. And it's not very surprising because Jackson Palmer initially created Dogecoin as a joke, a meme coin, and he was mocking the crypto space in its early days. But fast forward to 2021, and the space has changed. The infrastructure has been built, and the crypto space that we know today is very different than crypto when Dogecoin was created. But today, does Jackson Palmer have a point? Is he right? Is cryptocurrency a scam? Let's talk about it. Welcome aboard the Bitcoin Express. My name is Chase. Let's get to it. Jackson Palmer, the founder of Dogecoin, sent out a series of tweets criticizing cryptocurrency, and he stated, "After years of studying it, I believe that cryptocurrency is an inherently right-wing, hyper-capitalistic technology built primarily to amplify the wealth of its proponents through a combination of tax avoidance, diminished regulatory oversight, and artificially enforced scarcity." So to recap, he believes cryptocurrency is to make the wealthy even wealthier, keep the poor at the same level or even more poor, and also it's used for tax avoidance. He also went on to state, "The cryptocurrency industry leverages a network of shady business connections, bought influencers, and pay-for-play media outlets to perpetuate a cult-like get-rich-quick funnel designed to extract new money from the financially desperate and naive." Recap, cryptocurrency is being used to trick people, pump and dumps, Ponzi schemes, and there might be some truth here. We will get to that in this video. And then lastly, he stated, "Cryptocurrency is like taking the worst parts of today's capitalist system, corruption, fraud, inequality, and using software to technically limit the use of interventions, audits, regulation, taxation, which serve as a protection or safety net for the average person." So here he is stating that we have our traditional financial system, which is corrupt, but with cryptocurrencies, we're just turning it digital and we're making it even more corrupt. So he has a lot of different things that he said here, and there are parts that I agree with and parts that I disagree with. So let's first go into the disagreements using some statements from Brian Armstrong, the CEO of Coinbase. And in response to Jackson Palmer's tweets, Coinbase CEO Brian Armstrong said, quote, that crypto is simply providing an alternative for people who want more freedom. And this is a very key concept in crypto, freedom. And this is something that might be very hard to understand at first for someone that grew up in a first world country and also that maybe never traveled outside of the country. The idea to spend your money is a privilege that not everyone has in the world. There are over 8 billion people in the world, and only about 20% of those people live in first world countries. In first world countries, we have bank accounts, we have credit cards, we have investment opportunities. But what about the rest of these people? They don't have it. They may not have a bank account. They may not be able to spend money how they like. And some countries, there's no way there's going to be any investment opportunities. But with cryptocurrency, they now have the option. But I want to take this to an even more extreme example. This is something that I usually speak about in personal crypto conversations. I don't think I ever brought this up in a crypto video. Cryptocurrency, more important than spending it, is also bringing it with you wherever you go in the world. Through history, there have been many ethnicities and races that had to escape their country due to persecution. For example, the Holocaust. It doesn't matter how much money you had. You could have been a millionaire, a billionaire, cars, houses. You could not bring that with you to wherever you escaped. And even if we talk about today, Syrian refugees, they're having the same problem. And since the Syrian civil war officially began March 15, 2011, families have suffered under brutal conflict that has killed hundreds of thousands of people, and they are escaping. And again, if you lived in Syria, you had real estate, you had gold, you had silver, you had any asset, artwork, whatever it is, it does not matter. You could only pick up, go on a boat with your family and the clothes on your back, and you cannot bring these assets with you. So when you have cryptocurrency, you can pick up and leave. And I'm not talking about any specific cryptocurrency. What I'm speaking about is the idea of digital money that is outside the control of a government, so that if you do take that digital money, overseas to another country, it can't be taken away from you. And this is an extreme example. We don't even have to get this extreme. We can speak about people that live in a first world country that are happy with their lives. They have all the benefits, access to all the perks that they need. If they want to just simply pick up and maybe move to another country, they can bring their wealth with them. So it could be mobility, you know, from the extreme level, and then it could be mobility just for your average person, even if they live in a first world country. And again, of course, spend the money how you want. So this is the first thing. Maybe you're watching this, you live in the United States, you live in Canada, and you think this is crazy talk. Like I said, if these are the countries that you've always lived in your whole life and you haven't really ventured out or traveled to other countries, it's a hard thing to grasp at first, but eventually you realize the world is much bigger than the United States. The world is much bigger than Canada. And then the second point when it comes to cryptocurrencies, one of the positives is that it is, quote, a much needed breath of fresh air for those who believe that government solutions are often inefficient, overpromise, or underdeliver, Brian Armstrong noted. And this is why cryptocurrency was created. It was created to fight the fiat system. Not that there's anything inherently wrong with fiat, but over history, since the beginning of time, whenever a government has full control over the monetary supply, they abuse it. So then cryptocurrency came along. Is it going to fix it? No. There will always be corruption in the world. There will always be scams. There will always be thieves. But this doesn't mean we can try to fight against it. And this is what cryptocurrency is, because Jackson Palmer was stating that this is just going to amplify the system we already have of corruption. So I don't agree with that. But what I do agree with to some point is that this isn't going to fix it. I think that is also one of these pipe dreams in crypto. Look, guys, crypto's here, Bitcoin's here, it's gonna save us. No, that's not gonna happen. That's a fairy tale. It will help us, but we'll always have corruption. It will always be here until the day that we die. And a third positive, a very big one, is Jackson Palmer was speaking about this whole wealth inequality. It just makes the wealthy even wealthier, and it keeps the poor very poor. But the best way, the best example, is to liken cryptocurrency to becoming an accredited investor. Accredited investor laws are a good example. They were created with the best of intentions to protect regular people from scams, a noble idea, but what has been the actual result? They often made it illegal to get rich via investment unless you're already rich. So if you want to have an investment opportunity, one that is worthwhile in today, in let's say the United States, you need to be an accredited investor, which of course most people are not, or you need to know someone. And this is how it's always been in history. You do not have access to these opportunities, the best opportunities, because you do not fit into any of these categories. But we are seeing for the first time with cryptocurrency a major shift where the average person is on the same playing field. Will this make them rich? No, but they're on the same playing field and they have an opportunity. When we look at cryptocurrency today, if we had the same laws for Bitcoin and crypto that we have with traditional finance, I do not believe that anyone today, your average person, right? Your average person would not have access to cryptocurrency such as Bitcoin or Ethereum. You would have to be an accredited investor. It probably wouldn't even be until maybe Bitcoin was 100,000 or 150,000 that we were allowed to invest into it. And this is the first time in history that average people are front-running institutions. This never happened before. Your average college student, your average person making $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 a year is able to get into these investment opportunities before institutions. And this is for people that are living in first world countries, but what about people in third world countries? They never get the chance, even if they wait. So when it comes to these third world countries, these people who would have never had an opportunity in the past, never, even if they waited, not only do they have an opportunity today, but they are also on the same playing field. It is equal opportunity for everyone. So when someone criticizes cryptocurrencies, some of the major points you can bring up are wealth, mobility, and more equality of opportunity for everyone. However, there are points that Jackson Palmer made that I do agree with to some extent. He was mentioning how crypto is used to get rich for naive investors, and they think, oh, this is going to change the whole wealth inequality story, right? Everyone's going to be equal. That's not going to happen. And Brian Armstrong stated that crypto is not going to solve wealth inequality. it's not trying to create the same outcome for everyone. As we mentioned in this video, it gives them an equal opportunity, but it will not fix the problem of wealth inequality. Also, like Jackson Palmer said, there are many get-rich-quick schemes in the space. There are scams in the space. There's over 8,000 cryptocurrencies. Not all of them will be here in 10 or 20 years, right? 8,000 cryptocurrencies, maybe 10 will be here, maybe 20. We'll have to wait and find out, but certainly not all of them. And there are people that use cryptocurrency for crime. There are people that use cryptocurrency for tax avoidance. But what's very unfair about what Jackson Palmer said is that he just grouped everything together and he said cryptocurrency, and this could be very dangerous. In crypto, we tend to lean to one side and stay there. We either hate cryptocurrency or we love cryptocurrency. There's no in between, right? Really, you should be able to hate cryptocurrency, maybe such as Jackson Palmer is stating with these criticisms, but at the same time, find some positives in certain cryptocurrencies or certain aspects of cryptocurrency. And same thing on the opposite end, you can love Bitcoin, but then don't get into the danger of romanticizing Bitcoin, that it's beautiful, gonna change the world, crypto is gonna save lives and fix the world. No, it will help, but it's not going to make this world, you know, a fairy tale. There's positives and negatives to both sides. So with Jackson Palmer, it seems that he just grouped everything together and said it's all a scam. And of course, I do not agree with this, but within the crypto space, there are scams. And he also noted back in 2018, rapidly racing towards an oversaturation of cryptocurrencies to the point that their value and utility inversely approaches zero. And this is something I agree with. Out of all of these 8,000 plus cryptocurrencies, many of them will go to zero. So to recap, Jackson Palmer's tweets, these criticisms, he does have some valid points in them, but he applied it to everything in the crypto space. Not everything in the crypto space is a scam. I disagree with Jackson Palmer, along with Brian Armstrong, and along with many people watching this video. However, there are a few points that he did make in his criticisms that do apply to cryptocurrency, but just not to all cryptocurrency. Let me know what you guys think in the comments below. Like this video, subscribe to the channel. Thank you for listening, and I'll see you next time.